Breaking news coming in from Bet365, where every nail-biting overtime win, breakaway, pick six, three-point shot, underdog win, buzzer beater, shootout, walk-off, and absolutely every play in between is amazing. From football to basketball and hockey to baseball, whatever the moment, it's never ordinary at Bet365. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. 21 plus only. Must be physically located in Virginia.
Welcome on into the Utah Blockcast. Man, it's good to be back with you guys. We are in full swing with spring ball. We just wrapped up week one up at spring ball. We had pro day, so plenty to talk about. Brian, you're back in the saddle. How are you, man?
I'm great, man. There is no better day of my week than Monday night. And yes, I'm separating that from the rest of my Monday because the rest of my Monday doesn't have Steve Bartle just glowing, illuminating on my screen. How can that, like, sunrise, sunset? I can't buy Steve Bartle appearances.
You're too kind, Brian. You're too kind. But the people can't see it, so they don't know what you're talking about. I just have some really bright computer screens is all it is.
Yeah, Steve's made, like, you want to talk about, like, improvements, like, New Year's resolutions? Steve's literal, like, glow up for his setup? Man.
I wish the people could see it. I've worked hard to get the recording studio up to snuff. It's not what it was in Cam's basement, but my own little personal setup is, you know, we're getting there. We're putting in work. A new home will do that for you. So, man, Brian, it's good to be back with you. The last episode we did, we went on and on and on about heights and weights. I don't think I've talked about heights and weights in like that ever. So it was a lot of fun to go through the roster on the last one and just talk about and speculate about guys on the team. And so it was fun. And so, you know, now that spring ball is back, we actually have topics that we can maybe dive into, which will be fun, which will be good, which will be
we're
really,
not
really
gonna
good,
talk
I hope.
Yeah, the whole episode's not gonna be heights and weights, thankfully.
Yeah.
And for the all 16 of you who actually stuck it out for the entire podcast,
shout out to y'all.
Sorry. Yeah.
Yeah, and sorry.
This is your reward.
But shout out.
I'll buy you a Coke one of these days.
Yeah, let us know where you're at. We'll buy you a Coke, a Diet Coke. Coke Zero, probably, because I'm an addict now. Jeez. Yeah.
I'm glad you converted. That's a big move.
It is. I feel like an adult now.
All grown up.
I'm all grown up. I got
You're
my
not
office
sitting in the
and
basement.
I got
my
Coke Zero, and I'm an adult now. I do my taxes.
Has Mountain Dew sent you, like, the breakup playlist yet? The We Miss You?
No. No. Mm. I'm so much of an adult that, you know, breakups don't even faze me anymore.
Ooh,
yeah.
Okay.
No regrets. Anyways, Brian, let's get into this, man. But before we do, we have a message from our good friend, sponsor of the show, Podfather, and our buddy Britton Covey. So let's get to that first before we dive into this episode.
Hey guys, Britton Covey here. As my long time at the University of Utah is coming to a close, it's time for me to start thinking about my future. There's no one I trust more than Andrew McCullough at the firm of Brinley Sullivan for my estate planning needs. Give his office a call to set up a free consultation at 435-673-9220. Andrew's firm is headquartered in St. George, but he spends plenty of time along the Wasatch Front taking care of his needs. So call him and tell him that Britton Covey sent you.
More info at trustyourtrust.com.
All right, and appreciate Britton Covey and Andrew McCullough, the team down there and in Salt Lake, Brinley Sullivan, for sponsoring the show. As always, on this episode, we're going to give our thoughts on week one of spring ball. We'll highlight a couple players in Jaylon Glover and Van Fillingood. We'll continue the conversation about spring ball, talking about what week one is about and what maybe week two is going to look like, what it's going to be about, and what coaches might be looking for in week two. One thing that we're excited to do and incorporate more of is at UteZone, we have this thing called the Mod Squad, a.k.a. Bartle's Angels. We have a group of mods that do a great job on the UteZone boards. And if you're a subscriber, you know what I'm talking about. If you're not, it's a little round table of sorts that they put together. And one topic we want to bring here is what position group has the most approved this spring.
Who came up with that. Bartle's Angels? That's glorious.
I'm pretty sure it was Boomer. Like,
okay, yeah, that makes sense.
Like it could have been Jordan. It could have been Brian. Like, it could have been Stu. Maybe not Stu, but it could have been Stu.
Could have been Stu, yeah.
I can say that because I know Stu
is the tech guru of the crew.
He is.
Shout out to Stu. Boomer is definitely the... if we had to categorize each one of them as an angel, I couldn't do it because I actually haven't seen Charlie's Angels in forever. But Boomer seems like the idea part of the crew. I just want to, like, every time we have a meeting with them from now on, I just want you to go, "Hello, angels."
Yeah, I think we'll roll with that one. Bartle's Angels, they are quite the angelic presence to me on that on the UteZone board. And then we'll wrap up the show talking about two commitments that Utah picked up over the weekend, Mack Howard and Clayton Isbell. So we're pretty excited about those two, and we'll talk about them. But Brian, man, just real quick, thoughts from spring one, from week one of spring ball.
First week of spring ball, we saw nothing, right? Because we couldn't actually see practice. Right. But the good news is we did get to see faces, right? And I think you and I spent way too much time analyzing numbers on a sheet and a page. And I don't know that those numbers necessarily reflected what we saw once guys started to show up on the field, right? You know, the other part of it, too, we saw who Utah rolled out to talk to from the get-go. And there weren't a whole lot of surprises with that. We saw a lot of pictures of Cam Rising throwing footballs. I think that's got to get people excited. But most of all, we saw that this team that's kind of been, I don't want to say off the radar, but like kind of moving in silence, has just been doing the same thing that they've always done, and that's working.
Yeah. No, I think that's such a good point, Brian. Like, this team is just so about, like, the work. Every time you talk to these guys, it's just like, we've still got work to do. The work's not finished. We're not a finished product. We've got la, 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 la. Like, it's just like, man, like, just to, like, do you guys, can you, like, tell us that, like, you enjoyed the championship at all? The trip to the Rose Bowl? Like, could you just, like, let it ride for a little bit? But no, it's like these guys are, you know, just so about getting back to work and putting in the work for next season. And so it's been pretty cool to listen to, you know, the guys that have been here for a while, you know, talking about Brant Keithy, talking to some of the other guys, Cameron Rising, obviously, Tavion Thomas, and what he did last year. But just listening to those guys talk about it, but then also hearing from the new guys and the fresh faces on the team and hearing them kind of talk about the willingness to I guess buy into that as well, you know, where they're just here to contribute in any way that they can. I talked to Justin Medlock on Thursday, and he just talked about, you know, whatever is asked of me, like, I'm here to do it and I'm here to play it. Jaylon Glover and we can talk about him. We're going to talk about him, you know, pretty extensively here, but he was a guy where I spent probably 4 or 5 minutes talking to him, interviewing him on Tuesday. And man, first, let me tell you, like, the dude is an absolute unit. Like, he is built.
I wasn't quite sure where you're going to take that, because the dude is a lot of things, right? He's, you know, a baller athlete. He is definitely, you know, a chunk of granite or marble in human form. He's also an excellent promoter. He is a strong
Wiener Schnitzel.
Yeah, strong personality presence. You know, I think he's got some swagger, some charisma.
He's got a little bit of that.
Yeah. So there's a lot of directions you can go in, but also, he's a guy that we really got to start talking about, right? Already.
Yeah, that's no,
insane.
Already. Like, it's crazy. it's funny. So seeing him in person for the first time, you get a look at what he looks like. And man, Like, he posted some pictures from practice over the weekend, I think on Saturday. You know, there's one where you get a good look at those quads on him. And let me tell you, man, that's Quadzilla. Like, he, like, and I'm just, it's crazy how this kid is built, how he's constructed as a true freshman and what he came into the program looking like. And it's, I've talked to, we've heard from a couple people. It's looking good. You know, Kyle Whittingham, I don't want to say raved about him, but gave him a shout out day one that, you know, he looks good. Admitted that he put the ball on the deck one time. And credit to Jaylon Glover. He also talked about that and addressed that and talked about how disappointed he was in that. But I think, you know, I put it out there on Twitter. I'm planting my flag on Jaylon Glover Island. Like, I am there already through week one of spring ball. I'm absolutely there.
Yeah, you didn't have to, you know, like, report anything from me to get on board with that as well. I've seen the highlights, and it's such a weird, I don't want to say coincidence or parallel, whatever it is. But he is really a very fascinating combination of Zach Moss and Ty Jordan, how he moves, his running style. He has that forward momentum, that almost gravity, I think, as a running back, to where, where he creates his own momentum, and it's really hard to stop him when he's out, you know, running. And he is built exactly in the mold that Utah loves their running backs. And so,
yeah,
I think that's going to be the really interesting part about his, as he's already here showing up doing the things that he's supposed to do. How does Tavion Thomas respond to that, right? Because Tavion is the big dog in terms of, you know, what he was able to do last year, set the touchdown record, you know, really had a breakout season in a lot of ways, but wasn't consistent throughout the year, right? He kind of ramped up towards the end, didn't get a full off-season start. You know, running backs don't have to know quite as much when it comes to playbooks and things like that. Their role is pretty simple. It's take handoff, run downhill, score touchdown, right? And I think they like it that way, but he does have nuances to his game that he still has to develop. How does Jaylon push that? You know, I think Tavion comes across as a pretty well-motivated guy, but I think it's always good to have somebody that's just right there pushing you to be better.
You know, not only Tavion, but the rest of the group as well, right? Like, Makai Bernard, he's going to get better because Jaylon is here. Ricky Parks, he's going to get better because Jaylon is here. Chris Curry, all of these guys are going to benefit from Jaylon being here. Tavion coming back, obviously, and what he's able to do, like, when you bring in a talent like Jaylon, we're already talking about him like he's the guy, and he's not. Like, let's be clear. This is still Tavion's room. This is still, you know, his backfield. Like, he is the guy. Makai Bernard is still RB2. But, man, Jaylon Glover, like you said, Brian, the way that he's built and constructed, he's built like how Utah likes their running backs. Shorter stature, you know, bigger. It provides them that low center of gravity, right? The ability to make explosive cuts despite their size. He's got good athleticism. So really, really excited to actually see what Jaylon Glover looks like on the field in a Utah uniform. You know, you can watch film all you want, but actually seeing it, you know, in person, you know, at Rice-Eccles Stadium, at practices, if we could ever watch those, like, it's just a different feel, a different vibe. So certainly excited for Jaylon Glover. What we've heard on him through week one, certainly excited. It's only adding to the excitement for sure. So excited about him. And then another guy that I wanted to talk about was Van Fillingood. we talked about him in the last episode. He's dropped weight. He's down to 250. And, you know, seeing him in person on Thursday, it's made a difference. Like, he looks lean. For a defensive end, like, looking as lean as you can, as Van does, like, he's not, like, super lean. You know, like, this guy is just a freak in the weight room, but he looks a lot better. And I'm excited to see what and how that's going to benefit his game as a pass rusher, as a defensive end. But he certainly has put in the work with his diet to drop the weight and get down to a weight that will best serve him getting after the pass rusher. Or getting after the passer.
we might have to go from Van Fillingood to Van Fillingood because he's got me feeling some type of way right now, Steve. We talked about it. Like, somebody has to. I never know if I need to keep going or if I need to let the laugh play out.
Nope. I loved it.
But like, and maybe it's Dr. Feelgood. I don't know. He's rocking the 80s mullet. Whatever it is, like, the Vanimal is engaged, right? And we've talked about a little bit with him and in conversations and whatnot. You know, freshman year was not normal coming right into a COVID season. Everything that team had to deal with, he's really not had a really solid foundation to start off of. And I think, you know, he came in as an extremely strong, you know, very heralded recruit, kind of, I don't want to say was slow to engage. He had five games as a freshman, you know what I mean? But by the end of the season last year, he was looking like a veteran. And we love to talk about rushing the passer, right? Utah is Sac Lake City. At some point, we're going to have mayoral elections. You may or may not see an article out of one of us about that. Who's to say? But the bigger issue with the University of Utah is run defense. And yes, that's where he became elite in my eyes as a defender. I can remember just, you know, there are certain things that just get burned in my head. Sitting in the press box for the press for the Pac-12 championship game, watching him and how he defended the edge. And it was something that, you know, in years past where Utah didn't have a Mika Tafua, they didn't have a Bradley Anai, they didn't have, you know, some of these elite defensive ends, it was really easy for an athletic quarterback to get outside on a zone read or whatever it was. You can't do that on Van, and I think that's going to serve him extremely well. He's the angles that he's taking when he plays, how he contains his pursuit, all that kind of stuff. He looks like a guy that's playing confidently, and now coming into camp with a body that is lean, it is strong, it is powerful, it's explosive. That's just going to help him. And I think really that's a lot of what this program is all about, right? We want to see guys come in and have instant impact. But really what you want is by year two, year three, to see these dudes be like, whoa, he looks like a totally different player.
Yeah, you want to see that development, right? Like, Kyle Whittingham still harps on it. You know, as much as he talks about the importance of recruiting, he still calls Utah a player development program. And so, you know, seeing that over the span of 2 to 3 years with these guys, like, you want to see that. And I think we really saw Van progress over the season. And, you know, I talking to him on Thursday, you know, he talked about that, those games coming down the stretch in November and the big games that they played as kind of the games where he finally started to really settle in. And I asked him about, you know, playing with more confidence, and I thought it was just going to be him talking about, you know, I finally feel, you know, confident in my abilities. The game started to slow down. You know, I was just feeling better about my game. He took it in a direction I wasn't expecting. He talked about technique and how when you play with better technique, that's going to feed into playing confidently, and vice, you know, and the two go hand in hand together. And so, you know, he's a kid where he's got all the physical tools, the athleticism that you want, but he gets it. He understands that, you know, he can't just be the biggest, baddest dude out there. He still has to play the game the right way. There's still that respect for the game. When Van talks about playing, you know, at a more confident level, it comes back to his development and playing with proper technique. So I'm excited from that perspective. And what's crazy about Van, you know, with Gabe Reed not getting here until the summer, he's the elder statesman in the room. How crazy is that? He's the oldest guy in the room, basically.
Well, so, I mean, the most experienced, right? He's the leader.
Right,
but
right,
he's been in that role before. You know, at Corner Canyon, he was, in a lot of respects, the young leader of that team, even as a junior. And then as a senior, it was without a doubt his team. You know, I think just everything that he did, how he played, all that kind of stuff. For a lot of times, they were just looking to him to make plays at the end of games. You know, they had players and talent out there. I'm not trying to say that, you know, they weren't stacked, but he was the guy that was out there doing it. And in a lot of ways, he's now in that role in the defense. But I think the nice part about that is it's just, you know, the guys that are coming along with him are also guys that have that kind of natural leadership ability. You know, Jonah Ellis, man, I was excited about him coming in. You know, I was excited when we saw some gains on him, and like, and looking at some of the practice clips that we get sent, like you can see that he's getting kind of thick. He's not thick. He kind of thick. You know, not thick, but thick. Anyways, but he's a guy that grew up in the shadow of a famous father, and you just kind of learn naturally from being around that how to conduct yourself. I think we see it a lot with professional athletes nowadays, where it's like these dudes that grew up around professional sports are just so much better prepared for everything, you know. And so yep. Jonah's going to be a big aspect of that. I think, you know, Mickey Sungaturanga is a guy that we've talked about constantly. I think now is a great opportunity for him to step forward. You know, you got, like, it's hard because you've got edges and you've got DTs, you know. So, like, Dev Kafusi is going to be a leader in the room for the defensive line, but it's also kind of not, right? Like, he's not a full-time edge guy. So, it is Van's, you know, it's Van's show. And you know, as Van's go, he'll have to go far.
Yeah.
I wasn't sure where I was going with that one either.
Yeah, I wasn't sure where you were going with that either. But
all I can say is, like, load the van up and let's go, because we got to make it to LA by January.
Yes, sir. You know, you talked about Jonah Ellis. It's 6'3". He's up to 240, up to 245 maybe. They brought Connor O'Toole over from the offensive side. He's now a defensive end. Word is he's hovering around 240, 245 as well. And both of these guys are dudes with very good athleticism. So, Brian, you talked about growing up the son of a famous, you know, NFL player. It's more than just that, right? Like, he had brothers that have all played college, and some are now playing in the NFL. And so competing against that, right, every day essentially, is certainly something that's going to benefit him. And I'm sure he's chomping at the bit to get after it this spring and kind of showcase his progress. But, you know, it'll be interesting to see what happens with defensive end during spring ball. Obviously, when we say it'll be interesting to see, you guys know what we're saying. But it'll just kind of be intriguing to follow what happens at defensive end, who steps up, who gets the commentary, the good commentary versus, you know, the bad commentary, sort of say. Which kind of leads us into the next topic. You know, week one is just kind of like getting back into the flow of things, right, Brian? Mm-hmm. Kind of getting a feel for things. What are we looking for going into week two? What are coaches looking for going into week two of spring ball?
Well, you know, the big part about spring practices and everything like that is that there's the acclimatization period, which has increased from 5 to 7 days, right? So that's the limits on number of full contact practices, no more than 2 consecutive full contact practices in a week, no more than 75 minutes of full contact action during any practice session, and no more than 2 scrimmages in the preseason, right? So these are all things that have changed in recent years, and so that's why this week is helmets and shorts. You know, we used to call it helmets, I think it's just helmets only, shells. Do we call it shells? So shells, and then so I think shells are with shoulder pads, and then you're obviously fully padded. By the time the shoulder pads come on, nothing really changes. I mean, it's not a huge difference. Other than it's just one more piece of equipment you have to put on that feels, you know, a little too tight at times. maybe that's just the lineman in me. But I think what it is now is you've had a chance to get your new guys acclimated. They're kind of getting familiar with how the practice flow is, right? And that's a big deal, because for guys like Lander Barton, for guys like Justin Medlock, who are looking to step into a role and replace, in essence, legends on the defensive side of the football in Nephi Sewell and Devin Lloyd, it's going to be very different from what you did in high school. You're not stepping into the same system. You're not, you know, coming out directly from, you know, gym class or whatever it was that you had in seventh period or eighth period. And so that first week is about getting guys familiar. Now, as a coach, buckle the chin strap, because we are coming fully loaded to see what you got. Okay?
Let's go.
I want it balls to the wall for the entire week. Now, granted, it's spring period, right? So we're going to spend a lot of time teaching and talking and working through things. And it's going to be fun and casual and open, and nobody's going to be, you know, on edge by comparison to how it is in the fall. You're probably not going to get a whole lot of that's good-ish from Sharif, you know, at volume at 120 decibels. Your periods are going to be different now too, right? You're going to be working heavy with, you know, individual and heavy on technique, like Van was talking about, especially with all these young guys that are going to be stepping into roles. And Utah is kind of in a weird spot, right? Because, like, they have depth, but they kind of don't.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like there's guys on the roster, but, like, we don't really know if those guys are going to step in and be game day players and all that kind of stuff. So what's going to happen is that you're going to have these team periods and 7-on-7 and 9-on-7, you know, and group sessions where it's the atmosphere is going to ramp up and it's going to be intense and they're going to want to push guys and see how they react. You know, you're going to probably, if you're Morgan Scally, you know, maybe there's a rule that, like, we're not doing blitzes till week 2 or 3. He's going to throw a blitz in there. You know what I mean? And Jim Harding's going to throw his clipboard and swear at Morgan because we haven't worked on that yet. Blitz pickup. But that's how it's going to be. You're going to be pushed and pressured in a way that's, like, meant to kind of evaluate, okay, so we gave it to you easy. Where do you step up from here?
No, I like that. I like that a lot. And I think it's you're spot on there where, you know, you're going to throw things in there to throw guys off and mm-hmm. to see yes. how they react, right? Like, week one is all kind of like, okay, cool, you're getting into it, you're doing good, but now is when you start to kind of mix things up yeah. and see how players react. It's, you know, you talked about the depth, Brian, and how important it is for guys that clearly provide depth. We just don't know much about them, right? Like, this week, next week, and the rest, I mean, this week and next week really is going to be, like, kind of the opportunity for these guys to start to really kind of showcase their progress and showcase where they're at in the game, to showcase how much more comfortable they are with assignments and responsibilities and playing the game the right way. This is where we start to see a lot of the work in the offseason come together. This is where we see, you know, I guess a sorting out of sorts. We start to learn more about these guys.
Are you calling week two the sorting hat of Utah spring ball, Steve? Are we in sorting hat week?
I might be. I like that. And so,
what house are you going to be in? Are you going to be in house first team, second team? house injury pit?
and so, yeah, like, just don't be house slithering your way out of here.
House looking for the transfer portal because you're not going to be playing here. House exit strategy. House
Hufflepuff your way over to the sideline. House
Slytherin to the exit because you're not going to be playing here anymore.
Ravenclaw your way up the depth chart.
Oh, House Gryffindor is opening for you to see some playing time. But I think, you know, a good example of this that just popped in my mind is Koli Fayu, right? Like, I think that's a guy that really has an opportunity to make an impact in spring, right? We have the idea that Paul Miley is likely going to be the starter, but you have to have a backup there, right? And so you right. have to have someone at the center position. He's a guy that's been in the program, has some heralded recruiting stuff, and us being recruiting guys, like, sometimes we maybe contribute to that a little bit too much because we hear and watch these guys and we get really excited about them, but we also know, like, okay, he's going to get on campus and everything's going to change. And this is really, like you said, the sorting week where some of those guys are going to want to step forward. You know what I mean? And I think yeah. the bigger part of it too is that, like, if you're a coach, this is your first litmus test, right? For guys that have come in. You've given him a first week where it's kind of a little bit lower speed, a little bit more low key. Who got in there and got better that first week? Who got in their playbook? Who got studying? You know, who is catching on? A lot of that is, you know, some of it is just being a player, right? Like guys who just naturally catch on, smart, all that kind of stuff. But I think a good example of it too is Devin Lloyd. He's a dude that was always, always, always studying.
Studying is so important. It's so important. Speaking of studying, did you study for the mod squad debate on this one, Brian? So at UteZone, you guys have come to our subscribers anyway, members of our board have come to enjoy these roundtables of sorts that are a group of mods that we have on the site, like we were talking about earlier, Curtis, Brian, Jordan, and Stu. They do a great job of moderating at UteZone, and they've provided this little roundtable for some discussion. It's provided and sparked some good discussion, and one of the questions we wanted to bring to the show in honor of the Mod Squad was, what position group has the most to prove this spring? Brian?
The floor is mine.
The floor is yours.
See, this is like if it were sorting week and I just struggled through it and I didn't have an answer, I would be, you know, Hufflepuffing my way on out of this podcast. But the good news is I did do my prep. And really, I think it's one that just has been stuck in my mind for a while now. And it's the linebacking core, I think. It's twofold. One, I think you've got some new guys that are coming in that we've heard some really, really great things about. I think this is a position group that under Colton Swan has really leapt forward. Like, it's not a step. Like, they went full on, you know, long jump in terms of what he's done in terms of their production, how they stand out, how they play, how they recruit the position. There's a lot of guys in that room already that bring a lot of talent. Mo Diabate coming in as a transfer. How does he adapt to this system, right? You know, how do they use him? Does he become a package guy, or is he an every down linebacker? You know, Justin Medlock, Lander Barton's coming in at 6'4" now. And you watching the practice highlights that they send us, which I got to be honest, Steve, I'm going to take a little sidebar here. One of the practices is literally Brant Keithy running from one drill to the other, looking at where to throw the football. I need better.
Come on.
I need better. I'm sorry. I love Brant, and he looks great. That uniform looks supreme. I need a better clip than that. I don't want to see him transitioning clips from drills. Yeah. But that being said, like, Lander looks like a giant out there. He looks like an NFL linebacker.
In a very good way. Like, it's scary how good he looks.
Yeah, he does. And he looks natural, too. He looks natural. He looks comfortable. All these kinds of things. Now, how's that going to go in practice and everything like that? We're not going through the checklist and everything like that in terms of him getting the calls right. But this is a group that's been a strength at Utah for a long time now. And, you know, has all this recruiting and effort that they put into it, has it paid off in terms of guys establishing spots and finding the field? You know, Nephi Sewell was not exactly a heralded recruit, and he stepped into that position and just knocked everybody out. So that's one thing where I'm just like, okay, like, is that a good thing or a bad thing? Kenny Reed, same thing, right? Like, he's a walk-on, you know, that was originally going to Utah State, and he comes in and steps in the spring ball, and everybody's like, this guy's really good.
Yeah.
Where'd he come from? Who's his brother? Why is he here? Right? Hayden Fury, another guy that, you know, you can talk about. Yeah, you know, like, so what's going on here? Is it that, like, you know, these walk-ons are really that badass? Or is it, you know, that just that, like, there are guys that are working at different speeds? You know, is it that this new influx of talent is just taking some time to get there? Is it the injury stuff with the Calverts?
Yeah.
A lot of questions,
man. There's certainly things to prove. Each and every player in the linebacker room has something to prove. And I think that that's such a good point. Like, obviously, Lander needs to come in and prove that, you know, he's the real deal. Justin Medlock, same kind of thing. Prove that he's the real deal. Muamu Diabate, you know, proving that his decision to come to Utah was worth it. So, yeah, there's certainly a lot to prove. Hayden Fury, Kareni Reed, like, proving that Utah's belief in them as walk-ons, putting them ahead of, you know, maybe some heralded recruits in terms of playing time on the field, proving them right. You know, like, there's a lot to prove in that linebacker room. And so that was a group that I think we've all kind of pegged as the group that obviously has the most to prove. But one group that I think is the dark horse here, can I have a dark horse most to prove group? It's the safety position. You know, as much as we talk about Utah needing to replace two starters at linebacker, Utah also has to replace two starting safeties as well. And so that's, you know, that's 1,300 snaps between the two of Vontae Davis and Brandon McKinney. There's plenty to prove. And I think a lot of people kind of look at Cole Bishop as, you know, a penciled-in starter. And while he had brilliant flashes, you know, he still has to prove that the consistency is there in his level of play, that the lows aren't too low, that the mistakes have been lessened, you know, that he's been – that just, again, just proving that he's going to be a more consistent player. Who's going to be the other guy at safety? Or is it going to be Kamoi Latu? Is it going to be R.J. Hubert? Obviously, we've heard a lot about R.J. Hubert over the last few years. He has to prove that he can stay healthy, and Utah has to help him prove that, you know. And so Kamoi Latu came in as a recruit in that 2020 class, right? He was a 2020 guy, pretty sure he was, with Clark Phillips and that group. He's had a couple years now. We've seen some brilliant flashes. I think it was his game, his performance against USC, where he was named Freshman of the Week in the Pac-12. So he clearly has the bright moments, but he's got to prove that he's taking a step forward in his game. You know, and then the guys behind him. You know, we were talking about depth, and we know that Utah has some bodies at safety, but who is going to provide the depth? Is it going to be the true freshman Sione Vaque? Is it going to be a guy that switched positions halfway through the season last year in Bryson Reeves? Is it going to be Blue Stewart, a freshman last year came in with that group, the 2021 group, Ethan Calvert in that group? Is he showing progress? So there's a lot to prove in this safety room. And, you know, and so I think I'm most fascinated by the safety group just because there aren't the heralded, the high four-star type kids in the room like there is at linebacker with Lander, with Justin, with Carson, with Ethan Calvert, and the rest of the group. Like, who is going to step up under Morgan Scali and prove that they can, you know, be starters or be contributors in some way?
There's a lot to that discussion too, because I think when we think of Cole Bishop, we saw the way that he played, the plays that he made in a certain situation. And I think the one notation to make is really what Utah did is they adjusted a lot of their scheme to that Cowboy package. You know, as much as we'd love to talk about Harry Potter and how, you know, Cole and Kamoi need to expelliarmus the mistakes out of their, you know, out of their grasp. That Cowboy package is another theme of the offseason for me, because I think a lot of it, you know, like this is the new wand from Ollivanders. I'm really dipping into it here. I have fully exposed myself as a Harry Potter nerd. But this is the bottom line, right? This is a team that has been traditionally an even front defense, okay? And even at times, they've tried to go odd front with five down linemen, you know, trying to prove a point. And we've joked about this is going to be just an offense of defensive tackles and or an offense of tight ends and a defense of linebackers. Well, they are trending somewhat in that direction with the way that they play that Cowboy package. And the bottom line is this: Cole Bishop fits perfectly as that third safety, you know, because he can play up in the line of scrimmage. Like, he can play out in coverage. It makes his responsibilities a lot simpler in how he, you know, how he can play, and kind of lets him just take his instincts over. Now, has he evolved enough and learned enough to where they don't have to do that as much? They can just put him back there at one of those safety positions. Has Kamoi Latu gotten his emotions under control? And I love the energy and the fire that he plays with, so I don't want it completely under control, right? What I don't want is you trying to headhunt a dude in the end zone and getting kicked out of a game, because as long as the targeting penalty is there, that's going to be a problem, right? Mm-hmm. Not saying that he ever did that this year, but there may or may not have been a play where it was questionable. Those are the kinds of things that I look at with that position group. You know, Zamaya Vaughn moving over there. How healthy is Zamaya? Is that a good move for him? He did so well at cornerback. Is that going to be a good thing for him? And like you said, you know, I think there's just a lot of question marks with that group. And look, Scally's always going to have somebody ready to go. And if not, you know, there's somebody that out there that he'll go find that will come and step in.
No, Brian, it's such a fascinating conversation when you talk about some of these individuals and then talking about the scheme and how things can change. Because, you know, I think a lot of us, always just kind of view Utah as the 4-2-5 defense, and like that's what it is. Like you're so locked into 4-2-5 with a nickel defender. But what Utah has with all of this depth, they have versatility, they have options in how they can, you know, match up with defenses. You talked about the cowboy package, having three safeties on the field and having, you know, three defensive linemen, five defensive linemen at times. But that's kind of the exciting thing about having this depth and having these options. Guys need to prove that they're capable of executing when called upon. I think that's kind of the main thing of a spring ball, is getting an idea of who could do that in fall. And then fall is where you see guys really kind of solidify their status. But I think that's kind of the exciting thing when you're talking about this defense and having to replace certain guys, right? Like having a guy like Lander Barton and Muamu Diabate on the field potentially at the same time, you have two guys that are capable pass rushers that can blitz from the middle of the field, can rush from off the edge. What that does for you and what you're able to do with certain things, having a guy like Gabe Reed and Jonah Ellis, maybe Connor O'Toole at defensive end, and the versatility that they offer, you know, as typical, you know, defensive linemen with a hand in the dirt, maybe you drop them into coverage and, you know, you blitz, you replace them with Lander or Muhammad. The safety packages, right? And you know, just to kind of transition into the next subject, they added Clayton Isbell, transfer safety from Illinois State. And, you know, this is a guy that's, you know, he's 6'2", 220 pounds. He's listed at almost the same size as these guys like Muamu Diabate and Lander Barton that are playing linebacker, and yet he's coming here to play safety. He's pretty good. He's you know, he's capable in deep coverage, and the versatility that he adds to the mix is super exciting in terms of what you can do with the other safeties in the room.
And that's, you know, I think that's the uniqueness of what Utah has done in years past, is they've never just settled, right? Like, they haven't just sat back and said, oh, yeah, we're good, we'll develop. They're always on the lookout. I think you got to give a little, like, I have this feeling. I don't have any information on this one, but there was probably a little assist from Kyle Brennan out there. He's the athletic director. He probably doesn't want to lose a kid like Illinois State, but as soon as lose the kid like Clayton, you know, at a place like Illinois State. But you know, I'm sure as soon as he was in the portal, somebody gave him a phone call, says, "What do you know about him?" He's like, "This is a Utah guy," and that's the bottom line. Like, he is a big, physical dude, and he's not that elite, like, jump off the screen type speed. But he gets to his spot, and yeah. I think some of it is just because he is so large. Maybe some of it is just that they're playing against dudes that are 5'8 and 5'9 every time that they're in coverage, but he looks like he just towers over players when he's playing for Illinois State. And I think that gives Utah a lot of options, right? So if you have him back there, and he looks like Tevin Carter, that's the name that stands out in my mind. And Carter was an elite athlete when he was healthy. He was just absolutely electric. And so that's a really promising pickup for Utah. I think it's another under the radar find where it's just like, this is a guy that wants to level up. He clearly has the athletic ability. Go get him. You know what I mean?
Right. And so I brought him up before, you know, properly ending that subject, because I want to ask the listeners, you know, what group do you look at as the most approved? Who has the most approved? So I want to ask, you know, the listeners that are still tuned in to this point of the show with us, what position group in your mind has the most approved this spring? Is it linebackers? Is it safeties? Is it another group? Is it wide receiver? Is it offensive line? Is it defensive line? So would be curious to hear from you guys. Let us know, tweet at us, respond to us, whatever it may be. Let us know who you think, what position group has the most approved. So with that said, I wanted to do that, and I forgot. I got so excited to talk about Clayton Isbell that I forgot to do that. But getting back to Isbell, I'm super excited about this. This is a guy, like I said, played the majority of his snaps at free safety, roughly 300 snaps to about 200 snaps playing in the box. So he's a versatile guy. Moves well, as you said. When I watched him, I got Vontae Davis vibes, because a similar thing, right? Like Vontae never looked super fast, right? In how he moved, his strides, whatever it may have been. But he covered a lot of ground. Was he a center fielder, rangy type of single high safety? No, but very good in his halves. And I think that's kind of the safety that you're getting here with Clayton Isbell. He's probably better suited in a cover two type of deep coverage, if that's going to be his responsibility. But he has the versatility to get there, you know, from shorter alignments. He can get deep. He can disguise things. He's that type of safety that will provide Scally a lot of versatility. Him coming to the program, to Utah, is just a great fit, in my opinion. On just when you look at everything, the entire package, right? So he's coming here with 2 years of eligibility. So he's not a one and done, which is nice. You know, he's a guy that has a couple years here, but he's still only a two-year guy. With Nate Ritchie coming back, like, he's going to be somebody that you want to get on the field almost as soon as he gets back from his mission, right?
He can't get back soon enough, too.
Oh, man.
Can we have, like, something go on in New Hampshire, getting back home?
Yeah, seriously.
I mean, not really, but, like, maybe.
Come on, maybe. Yeah,
please.
Maybe he just misses football. Maybe, yeah, you know, he's so you have Isbell, and he's here for 2 years. He's gone after next season, and Nate Ritchie's able to come back in and kind of assume things like they were. Good fit in terms of scheme and what he's able to do and playing certain responsibilities, certain coverages. Very good fit there. He's a fit in terms of the personality and persona and identity of Utah football and the Utah defense. You mentioned it, Brian. He's a physical guy. He tackles. He packs a punch. And just an overall really good fit. So love the fit with Isbell. And I think it's important that, I don't want to say it's important. Like, obviously it would be nice to have him here for spring ball, but with what he's accomplished at Illinois State, being a two-time All-American and not showing up to Utah until this summer when he graduates, is it gives these younger guys all of the reps in spring ball. It allows these younger guys the opportunity to be coached up and to develop. And I think that's such a valuable thing for these young guys, to where it betters the group as a whole. I don't want to say we can count on Isbell to come in ready to go, obviously, because we don't know. But when you're a two-time All-American, you've kind of proven that you can play. And we learned last year, Brandon McKinney didn't show up until summertime, and he proved to be a guy that Utah could count on and lean on. So I think just in terms of everything, when you look at Isbell, what he's bringing to the program as a player, the fit in terms of his eligibility when he arrives, it's just an ideal fit for Utah in so many different ways.
Well, if I were to ask you, and going back through the conversation of the podcast so far, like, what are the most important things to do within the first 2 years? It's work on your technique and understand the scheme, right?
Right.
Yeah. Like, so he's done that, and you can see it on the film. You know, he is pretty technically sound. I'm watching it again, man, and he is so versatile. Like, there's times where he's lining up as a slot corner. And some of that is just at the level that he's playing at, you know. And I don't want to knock those kids, because those kids ball out. And like, there's a lot of dudes that come from that level. Oh, my gosh. I just watched him blitz. And like, that's the thing. Like, you watch it, and you're just like, okay. Like, yeah, Morgan's going to have to, you know, sand it down and really polish it a little bit. But for the most part, the statue's kind of cut. Like, he's got his David going on. You know, so there's not a whole lot of like, really the hard work that you have to do with him. And that's, like you're talking about, man. Get the young guys developed. Give these guys the reps. This is why spring ball is so important. You know what I mean? This is why we obsessed over it, for two reasons. One, because we're football junkies and we have to have it, and I can't go more than a few months without it. Two, because it is really, really critical for a developmental program, and Utah is always going to be a developmental program as long as Kyle Whittingham's the head coach, as long as whoever the next head coach is, they're always going to have to develop to a degree. I think Alabama is a developmental program, so every program should be one. That being said, like, it's really critical for these guys to get this development now, because you're not going to get snaps in season. And as someone who took their biggest step as a player in spring ball, I can tell you that you are positioning yourself right now to either be ahead or behind when everybody else shows up in the fall, and you want to be ahead. Little experience. First year of snow college, I'm a walk-on there. Practice squad, you know, like I'm a full-blown taxi guy, right? And we got our butts kicked every single day up until like the last 2 weeks of practice where like we'd finally, you know, gotten to a point where we could hold our own. And snow college had one of the elite defenses in the nation. I come into spring ball because we had a few good weeks at the end and I've got some confidence. Couple practices in, I'm stopping some dudes in one-on-ones. I know what all the scheme is. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, oh yeah, inside zone, I got this. Zone step, get grouped. I'm like, all of a sudden my double teams are getting movement. All of a sudden it's really easy to feel when I need to slide off a double team and pick up the backer. All of a sudden, like these relationships that I've had with these dudes that I've been practicing with all along that we're now getting in twos and threes, you know, as opposed to being bottom of the barrel. We're doing good things, right? Now I'm getting to work with the ones. Now I'm getting slid out to tackle a little bit. All these good things are happening in spring. I'm building all this confidence. What happens in the fall? Well, I'm still walking on. So depth chart drops and all the scholarship kids that are coming their first time are in front of me. I'm back to fourth string. But in my head, I'm like, there's no way that kid that's coming in right now has any clue what he's in for. And so I went out the first couple weeks. Within a week, I'm back up to two on the depth chart. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And look, at that point in time, like injuries started to catch up with me. I was older playing in a game that like you really need to start out when you're young. And you know, also I was playing behind all Americans, you know, like guys that went to Cal and
yeah, you were
and everywhere. So I was probably really at my almost at my peak without, you know, investing way too much more time or my body into it. Mm-hmm. But I was comfortable with that. I played a lot, you know, I got to start a couple games. It fed the itch that I had. But that was the trigger moment for me. It was that spring ball where, okay, all of a sudden I'm much more familiar with this. I'm playing against some of these dudes that are going to Texas A&M or, you know, wherever else all our defensive line that I, dude, this is how good the defensive line was my year at Snow. All four starters left after spring. They didn't even play in the fall. They left after spring to scholarship programs. So, like, that's what this whole – and we're really into the weeds on this spring ball thing from, you know, from Clayton Isbell. Yeah. But, like, that's why you can go out and get a dude like him, right? Because you know this is what you're going to do in the spring. And on the flip side of it, Isbell's been through all that. So – I think it's a great pickup. I'm excited about him. I think he's a great fit for the program. You talk a little bit about like the cloud cover two coverage. As I'm watching some of this, man, like his ability to do some things in coverage has me very curious.
Oh yeah. No, like he can do some things. He can turn and run. He can flip his hips a little bit. Uh-huh. He can drive on the post. He can play some single high. He can play from cover one.
He's not going to be your every down cover high, like he's not Vontae, right?
He's not Marcus.
Vontae Davis really did hold things down. Like, and my goodness, if ever I had to backpedal on a dude, like I was out on him 2 years ago. Vontae, shout out to you, man. You proved me wrong. I love it. But you know, like you've got enough dudes that I think can play the post, right?
Yeah.
He's a dude that you can really move around. And again, we talk about that cowboy package.
Oh yeah.
You slide him down and low. Mm.
Yeah, it's that versatility is nice. So you know, you're talking about spring ball. Where was I going with that?
It's nice to get things, you know, set in stone in spring.
I'm blanking. Anyways, I'll just roll with it. Utah picked up another commitment over the weekend, and this one is pretty exciting. Mack Howard, quarterback out of Mississippi, four-star kid, played for Heritage something program, and will now be playing at Oxford High School his senior season, which is a step up in competition. So it's basically like going from, I guess, 4A, 5A maybe, up to 6A. So it'll be... that'll be good for him. But Mack Howard is a guy. This was Utah's top target at quarterback. They were involved with three other quarterbacks primarily: Jabari Johnson, Mack Howard, and then the kid from Florida that they just offered not too long ago, Marcus Stokes. They bring Mac out for an unofficial visit, and they take his commitment, while the other two quarterbacks certainly had a lot of interest in Utah. Getting Mac Howard now is so valuable, right? You're able to get his voice added into your recruiting efforts, get his presence, you know, in the class established, and how valuable he's going to be moving forward. Man, it's super exciting to think what impact Mac Howard committing now. This is a guy from SEC country in Mississippi. To pluck him now, to get his commitment locked in now in March, after just 6 months of recruiting him, and he became your top target, like, that really says a lot about where Utah's at.
I know we love to play off the star rankings, and he is a four-star recruit. You know, his average is 91.9147. That's all well and good. You know me, Steve. Numbers and I, like, we're
estranged.
We're side-eyeing each other. It's like me and it's me like Harry and Severus. You know, where there are times where we work together, but I don't know that we really like each other. But what I do love is I love to look at offer lists, right? And see who a guy has been offered by. And you look at this one and it's like, oh my gosh, you know, Houston, Dana Holgorsen, who is someone that I know how Holgy looks. Like, I promise you, this is an offensive genius. This is one of those dudes that knows things, right? You look at an offer from Florida State. You know, that's a program, or interest, I should say, from Florida State, right? That's a program that's coming hard on the recruiting trails, that's really looking to big and glow up, to grow up, improve, whatever.
Glow up, grow
yeah,
up.
Yeah, glow up.
It's all the same. Probably more grow up at Florida State.
Yeah. Mississippi State, Ole Miss, Wisconsin. Like, those are names on there with people that, in my mind, are the kind of offensive minds that I want scouting guys, right? And so I think that really, to me, it shows one of two things. One, Utah was in on it early. They knew what they had. They knew they needed to get this kid on board immediately, and they got business accomplished. Two, we're going to see the same thing that happened with Nate Johnson happen to Mac Howard. It's just, call my bluff. You know what I mean? If all these people were circling and starting to get on board, it was coming. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And so I think that, to me, is an even bigger, you know, and not to mention the film is great, right? Like,
oh, yeah. Watch the film if you haven't.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
Yeah. And you know, 6'2", 185, he's that prototypical size that you and I are kind of starting to really, really love, that 6'2", 6'4", you know, it, like, has some room to grow into it a little bit. And so I think, it's twofold, right? I think this is a big one for Chad Bumpus. Because this is, you know, him kind of going out on the road and getting a dude that really contributes to the program. Two, you're now creating a legacy at Utah of just, what do we get at Utah? Four-star quarterbacks, you know? Like, eat a sandwich.
Isn't that crazy? Like, that's crazy, right? Like, they've now, four of your five quarterbacks that had recruiting ratings, you know, that are guys that you recruited are on scholarship. Bryson Barnes is the only guy that isn't. On scholarship, but even Brandon Rose is a high-level three-star. Four of your five rated quarterbacks in the room are four-stars. Like, that's crazy, and I know we're not four-star, we're not stars, we're not hunting for stars, but it really says a lot about the talent in the room.
Yeah, again, it's the offer interest list, right? Like, it's all those programs that are sniffing around and looking at him. Like, and here's the thing, if you're a team like Ole Miss, if you're a team like Florida State, like you're trying to get in on the high-end recruits, but also what you're really looking for are the program fits and the guys that you really like. And so they're doing the same thing that Utah is, where they're trying to, like, you know, like, show interest and love up Mac, because they know as soon as he busts through that they can go in and have the edge against, you know, the Clemsons or the Alabamas or whoever else it is that might come in afterwards that has more cachet as a program. But also, these are guys that know offense and develop quarterbacks. So it's like, Utah's done a really good job on this one. Shout out to our buddy Tag Butler at 801_Ute on Twitter, who had this tweet, said, teams that signed a four-star or higher QB in each of the past three classes. This is a decent list. Ohio State, Alabama, Tennessee, Texas A&M, Miami, Notre Dame, Georgia, LSU, and Utah.
Yeah, that's pretty good company.
Is that okay?
That's pretty darn good.
Can we live
company.
With that, Utah fans? Is that we need to narrow that list down? Or are we okay being, you know, part of the blue blood group? You know, I think, you know. So it's just this is we've been talking about when the recruiting bump would come, you know, from Utah's success.
Yeah,
it's arrived.
Yeah, no, it really has. And you know, one thing that I mentioned briefly was just the amount of time that it took for this to come together, right? Utah only started recruiting him in November. Like, that's what's crazy, right? It wasn't too long ago when Utah was recruiting the Jack Tuttles and the Peter Costellis, where it took 2 years of groundwork just to be in the game with him as these other programs entered the equation for them, and they're able to secure their commitments. Like, we are past that. We are now to the point where four-star quarterbacks recognize Utah as a quality offense, as a quality offense for quarterbacks, and it's just an amazing evolution under Andy Ludwig and what he's been able to do. And really says a lot that, you know, he had two visits scheduled, one to Utah and one later on to Pitt. You look at what Pitt has done. They have Kenny Pickett, likely going to be a first-round pick, and yet Mac decides to go with to follow Cameron Rising. And what he's doing, I talked to him prior to his trip to Utah. You know, he referenced Alex Smith and he referenced Cameron Rising as quarterbacks that he looked up to and modeled his game after, really. So really says a lot about what Utah's doing on the recruiting trail, kind of the benefits of the success that they've had. I know we want to see more quantity of four stars, but there are a lot of ways that their success on the field is translating on the trail. And this is one thing where you're seeing a guy that you just start recruiting 6 months later, you know, you're the favorite to lock him down. So pretty impressive. He'll be joining a strong quarterback group, assuming everybody stays intact, obviously. And that's kind of something that it's hard to count on. But when you look at the group following Cameron Rising, who is kind of expected to leave after the season, you've got a good collection of talent in the next quarterback battle. So it'll be a lot of fun to see what shakes out over the next year, what Mac looks like his senior season, and that quarterback battle, you know, hopefully next spring because Cameron Rising has moved on to the NFL draft. It'll be a lot of fun for sure.
I think they've done a good job with finding a variety of guys too. You know, you've got the elite athlete, Nate Johnson. You've got the fiery competitor, the fiery underdog in Brandon Rose, who, like, I mean, honestly, he could play QB at half the schools in the Pac-12. And you've got a guy in Mac Howard now who is, you know, I think once camp season and everything like that is done, he's going to be, you know, on the list for one of those elite level quarterbacks. You just pocket presence, how he moves. He's an athlete. He's got a killer arm. You know, you mentioned that he's going up a level in Mississippi. He'll have a chance to get guys, you know, as he goes through the camp circuit and everything like that, on board with coming to Utah. That's going to be a big deal. And Utah's just going to continue to improve. You know, not all those guys are going to stay here. That's just the game. But the bigger part about it is that you're now a player in it. And like you said, in the matter of 6 months, you've gone from scouting, hunting, and closing one of the better quarterback prospects. You know, 2, 3, 4 years ago, this would have been like, whoa.
What?
And everybody's like, yep, that's just what we do here. So. Yep.
So pretty cool. So a lot of good things happening up on the hill for Utah football. Obviously, spring ball will be back up there for media availability on Tuesday and Thursday. And then obviously recruiting, they are just on a little bit of a heater right now with what they're doing on the trail. So pretty exciting. And obviously our good buddy Dog has become the quintessential bat signal for Utah recruiting, which is always fun to see. So shout out to Dog and shout out to the listeners for tuning in. Brian, any last thoughts before we put a bow on this thing?
Enjoy yourselves a butterbeer, everyone.
I knew it was going to be Harry Potter. This has been the Utah Blockcast. Signing off.
Breaking news coming in from Bet365, where every nail-biting overtime win, breakaway, pick six, three-point shot, underdog win, buzzer beater, shootout, walk-off. and absolutely every play in between is amazing. From football to basketball and hockey to baseball, whatever the moment, it's never ordinary at Bet365. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. 21 plus only. Must be physically located in Virginia.
JCPenney es la parada más inteligente este regreso a clases. Con más moda y miles de ofertas por menos de $20. Encuentra lo que tus niños necesitan y vístelos de pies a cabeza. De mochilas a medias, de polos escolares a Puma y de camisetas a cortes de cabello. Para los universitarios encontrarás de cargos a crop tops, de sudaderas a salón de belleza, de pantalones a perfumes y de toallas a tostadoras. Esta es tu única parada este regreso a clases. JCPenney, vale la pena. Ofertas válidas hasta el 28 de julio.
Breaking news coming in from Bet365, where every nail-biting overtime win, breakaway, pick six, three-point shot, underdog win, buzzer beater, shootout, walk-off, and absolutely every play in between is amazing. From football to basketball and hockey to baseball, whatever the moment, it's never ordinary at Bet365. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. 21 plus only. Must be physically located in Virginia.
JCPenney es la parada más inteligente este regreso a clases. Con más moda y miles de ofertas por menos de $20. Encuentra lo que tus niños necesitan y vístelos de pies a cabeza. De mochilas a medias, de polos escolares a Puma y de camisetas a cortes de cabello. Para los universitarios encontrarás de cargos a crop tops, de sudaderas a salón de belleza, de pantalones a perfumes y de toallas a tostadoras. Esta es tu única parada este regreso a clases. JCPenney, vale la pena. Ofertas válidas hasta el 28 de julio.